1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. The scripture is also on the screens for you to see as well. And we're just standing, as is our custom here at New Vision. If you're able to stand, if you have the capacity, physically, if you can stand, please stand. Starting with verse number 19, it says, "They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. And in due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son. And she called his name Samuel, for she said, I have asked for him from the Lord." This is the word of the Lord. And the church said,
amen.
I want to preach today from the topic, from trauma to triumph. From trauma to triumph. You may be seated. Holy Spirit, you are here. We asked you to open up the sky. And you sent manna in the Old Testament, but you have sent your word for us as New Testament believers to feast. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of your mouth. And so as we step to this scripture, dear God, we pray that you would speak. Would you make it rhema, Father? May it leap off the pages into our life. Help us, dear God, to live in such a way that honors you and to know that we have overcome with Christ Jesus. Anoint me now, Father, to speak to this group of people, and may we be transformed because of this preaching moment. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. In today's passage, we meet a woman named Hannah. And Hannah is what I would describe as a unique living situation. Now, this is coming at the tail end of our Family Matters series. So we've been talking about family, first natural, then spiritual. And we've come to the conclusion that families are not perfect, but we serve a perfected Savior. And our goal is to be more like Jesus in the context of spiritual family and also natural family. But it's also important to note that sometimes we can't embrace spiritual family because we have dysfunction in our natural family. And if I took time to pass this mic around and to hear about everybody's situation, where they came from, how they grew up, I guarantee you we would have more stories of dysfunction than function. If we're honest, if you continue going back into your family tree, maybe you came from a solid nuclear family, but I guarantee you in many cases, your parents or your parents' parents dealt with things that probably haven't even been mentioned and talked about. And Hannah, in this scripture, is in a really strange situation. You can see in verse number 2, she was married to a man named Elkanah, and he had two wives. Somebody say two wives. The name of one was Hannah, and the name of the other was Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. Now, let's take a moment to unpack this verse, because some of y'all are tripping at the statement of two wives. Some of y'all are crazy enough to want two wives, and so you're going to try to use this as a justification for polygamy. And some of the fellas are saying, I'm just trying to figure out the one that I got. It's important to note that scripture is at times descriptive but not prescriptive, meaning that just because you see multiple wives in the text as we peer into the life of their story doesn't mean that that is prescriptive and something that God wants for us. In fact, if you read, you'll see the drama that comes in the life of this man who now has two wives because there is a rivalry going on in the midst of their household. There is tension. Now, from all accounts in the scripture, it seems that Elkanah is a godly man who loves both of his wives, but especially Hannah. But what we learn in the scripture is that Hannah is barren, which may give us insight as to why he took a second wife who was fertile so that he could bring forth an heir for his family. The scripture says in verse 3, "Now this man used to go up year by year from his city to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts of Shiloh, where there were two sons, Eli, Hophni, and Phinehas, who were priests of the Lord." So now we see that Elkanah is a God-fearing man. He goes regularly to worship, and on the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to Peninnah, his wife, and to all her sons and daughters, but to Hannah he gave a double portion, because he loved her, though the Lord had closed her womb. In ancient Israel, meat was given to a wife in proportion to the number of kids they produced. Because the idea was you give a certain amount of meat to this wife because she has this many kids. So for Elkanah to give Hannah a double portion, even though her womb was barren, meant that he was really sensitive to the reality of her situation. Verse 5 indicates that Elkanah loved Hannah even though the Lord had closed her womb. Say that the Lord had closed her womb. That's enough to give some of us pause, because the scripture doesn't say that the devil closed her womb. The scripture doesn't say that the adversary, the enemy, closed her womb. The scripture says that the Lord closed her womb. And in ancient times, it was believed that a closed womb was a result of God's judgment on a woman and a family. Now, that's important because some of us wrestle with the idea of serving a God who would close the womb of a faithful woman. Based on your response, I know I'm walking down the right row. We wrestle with the idea of a God who says he's good but allows trouble in our life. We like the idea of a God who saves us and rescues us from all types of situations and circumstances. We don't like the idea of a God who allows those circumstances to shape us. Some of us are wrestling with the goodness of God in view of things that happen to us that aren't necessarily good. Case in point, next week is Mother's Day. But it's a bittersweet day for many of you. One, because many of you are grieving the absence of your natural mother who passed away. And watch this, some of you are still wrestling with God as to why he took your mother as soon as he did. As Sylvia said, we can question God without questioning the character of God. But when we are weak, we start to wonder, is God really good because he took someone that was close to me? Mother's Day is bittersweet because some folks are mourning the loss of a baby before or during pregnancy. In fact, statistically, 1 in 225 pregnancies end in stillbirth. And so some people have difficulty with Mother's Day because you're reflecting on what could have happened but what didn't happen. And it still hurts. The pain of having to go through that process is almost too much to bear. And others are lamenting their infertility and their inability to conceive and carry a child. In fact, about 1 in 5 couples deal with infertility. And so when we have a moment like Mother's Day next week and everybody's celebrating and there are flowers everywhere and there's all of this sunshine, some of us are still dealing with the darkness of our hearts because we have questions for God. I need you to know that your questions for God don't shake him. He's sovereign. He's immutably God. In fact, trusting in his sovereignty is what helps us to get past the questions that we might have. So here's the question, the larger question, because this message is not just for mothers. This is also for brothers. Because brothers go through things. Young people go through things. Older people go through things. That is the human dynamic, that we go through stuff. Here is the greater question. If God is good, then why does he allow bad things to happen? If God is good. Now, some of us used to say, if God is good, why does he allow bad things to happen to good people? But we understand as believers that theologically we're not good. We have issues. We have problems. In fact, God doesn't give us what we actually deserve. He dispenses grace and mercy, which pushes us to say, God, why even allow bad things happen? If you are all powerful, why don't you just stop it? Why don't you just intervene into history and to stop what's happening? I need you to understand that we live in a fallen world, a broken world, and much of what we see happening around us is because of the presence of sin. And sinful people do sinful things. Sin creates a broken environment where things that God did not originally intend happen because we live in a broken environment that has been tainted and corrupted by the reality of sin. But thank God for Jesus, who's coming back to restore the shalom that was in the very beginning, which is why we have an eternal hope, an eternal expectation that God will one day deliver us from this ghetto called life. But in the midst, we've got to have a strong theology. So here it is. If God is good, why does he allow bad things to happen? There's a term you need to become familiar with. It's called theodicy. Say that, theodicy. God, judgment. Theodicy is the premise that if God were on trial for the existence of evil, the reality that he would be vindicated because of his sovereignty. Theodicy is the explanation of why a perfectly good, almighty, and all-knowing God permits evil. It is a defense of God's goodness and omnipotence and the view of the existence of evil. Theodicy is the position that God is good even though bad things happen. In fact, in his sovereignty and his divine attributes, he is trustworthy to help us navigate the reality of evilness in the culture in which we exist. Theodicy addresses the problem of evil by relying on three divine attributes of God. Number one, the idea that God is omnibenevolent. Number two, the notion that he is omnipotent. And three, the notion that he is omniscient. Number one, we believe that God is omnibenevolent, meaning that he is perfectly good. He is all loving. He is fully merciful. That are the attributes. Those are the attributes of him revealed in Scripture. Secondly, we believe that God is omnipotent. He is indeed all powerful. And on top of that, he is omniscient, which means that he is all knowing. If we backtrack that, whatever you're going through, you need to know that God knows and he cares. He sees. Man looks on the outside, God looks at the heart. You need to know that God sees what you're going through. He knows because he is omniscient. Then on top of that, he is omnipotent. He has all power. Even though you feel powerless, God has not degraded in his power from the throne, but you've got to trust that he's omnibenevolent, that if he's allowing you to go through what you're going through right now, then there's got to be a purpose in the midst of your pain. And God, because he works all things together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose, we've got to trust that what we're going through is working for our good. So Theodicy says that even though I'm going through a tough time, I trust that God is good. I trust that he has power in his hands. I trust that he knows what I'm going through, and I'm going to worship him in spite of my disappointment. It's okay to acknowledge that you've been disappointed before. For it's okay to acknowledge that you came in here jacked up, halfway walked into worship because it seems like the devil's been taking advantage of you all week. It's okay to acknowledge that this week you wrestled with depression and you started feeling the doldrums because you're remembering mom and she won't be here next week. But I'm here to tell you that God is still fully qualified to be worshiped in the midst of your questions, in the midst of your pain, in the midst of you missing those who are closest to you. We serve a God who is trustworthy. And if it doesn't happen now, one day it will all make sense. But the key is we have to worship him in spite of. And I don't know what pain you're carrying right now. Maybe you were in that list. I talked about those who lost mothers. Some of you have lost babies. Some of you have not had the opportunity to do what you desire to do, and your womb is still empty. Let me tell you that God is still good despite the reality of your current situation. And let me mess with your theology even more. Even if he doesn't bless you with a child, he's still good. Because even when it seems like in certain areas we aren't blessed, all we have to do is begin to count our blessings and to see his mercy operating in our life. I'm not just telling you what I know. I'm telling you what the scriptures teach. This is the call of the believer. And so now we've got Hannah in this situation. Her womb is barren. And God is the reason why she's barren. And this is creating trauma in her life. Because every day she has to wake up and look at the other woman. And this other woman knows that she's barren and flaunts the fact that she's fertile in front of the barren one. So every day she's trying to serve her family. Every day she's trying to love her husband. Every day she's trying to do what she's supposed to do, but she has the reminder of the trauma of her life. The word trauma is a Greek word that literally means wound, hurt, or defeat. We've talked about this before at New Vision. Trauma is real. There's little T trauma and big T trauma. Some of you have had some major events in your life. I'm here to let you know that you're here by the grace of God because it should have taken you out. For all intents and purposes, for the natural things that happen to you, you should be out your mind. You should be walking the streets right now with no clothes on and no shoes on your feet. You should be locked up somewhere. But God, watch this, God kept you through the trauma that you endured because he's omniscient. He's omnipresent. He's omnipotent. But you got to trust his goodness even in the tough times, in the dark times. There's little T trauma. There's big T trauma. But I'm reminding you today that we serve a big G God who heals our wounds. God is big enough to handle our little trauma and our big trauma. In fact, he sent his son Jesus to endure trauma so that we could be set free. Isaiah 53 and 5 says, for he was wounded for our transgressions. He was traumatized for our transgressions. He was traumatized for our transgressions. He was traumatized for our transgressions. His blood was shed for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, but by his stripes we are healed. Jesus endured trauma so that we can get our healing. And when you know Jesus, there's no trauma in the earth that can't be healed, because we serve a creator. We serve a God who overcame death and the grave. Tell somebody, by his stripes I am healed. I need you to get some authority right now. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what pain you're holding, but somebody needed this today. Because all day you've been telling yourself that you're the victim. All day you've been telling yourself that I'm wounded and I can't get up. All day the enemy has been in your head and in your mind telling you to take your life, telling you to give up and throw in the towel, telling you not back to go back to that crazy church with all them people that don't care about you. But here, by the divine grace of God, you're in this place with this message coming for you. Repeat after me, by his strength I am healed, and I'm in my healing process. This is part of my therapy right now. God sent me to this place, not just so I can go to the wellness pop-up, not just so I can get my blood pressure test, but now the blood is testing my pressure. The blood of Jesus has the ability to stabilize me, to help me, to empower me. It's the blood that gives me strength from day to day, and the blood will never, ever lose its power. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, just look at somebody right now who's got their hand lifted. Let their testimony encourage you. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, Jesus died upon the cross. I know it was the blood for me. I'm not just here because I got a therapist. I'm not just here because I've been to school. I'm not just here because somebody mentored me. I'm here because of the blood. Somebody say, my trauma doesn't define me. So let's get back to the text. So we start off looking at Hannah's trauma, but don't just stop at her trauma. Keep reading, because eventually her trauma is addressed and God shows up. Some of us in life, we stop reading. We get stuck on what happened, but like Raj, we need to know what's happening. You get stuck on what happened, and God is saying, don't be so fixated on what happened that you can't see what's happening. Behold, I do a new thing. Behold, I'm working right now. Behold, I'm setting something up for you. Behold, I've got something going on, and it's got your name on it. I've got weeping now may endure for tonight, but joy cometh in the morning. Tell somebody, morning is coming. So Hannah is enduring trauma, and the trauma lives in the house with her, and her rival. Somebody say her rival. Let me help you understand something about rivals. We know, according to the New Testament, Ephesians chapter 6, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and wickedness and rulers in high places. So when you have a rival, you have to recognize the spirit behind your rival. The spirit behind your rival, and the enemy will send a distressing spirit on someone to distress you. Because when you start looking at Hannah and her profile and who she is, she's one of the most prolific people in the Old Testament. She is marked in history because of her faith and belief in God, in spite of the fact that she had some things going on that she did not like or love. But her rival used to provoke her grievously. Her rival irritated her every day because the Lord had closed her womb. Isn't it just like the enemy? Isn't it just like the enemy, and then try to spiritualize it and then include God to get you to a place where you're not operating the way you're supposed to? The enemy is so crafty. He will try to use the sovereignty of God against you, but you need to know that all things work together for the good of those who love him, that the sovereignty of God is working on behalf of those who love him. So at some point, God's going to flip the script. People will provoke you. They provoked Hannah to the point, she, her rival, that she didn't want to eat. And all she would do is cry. People will provoke you. To provoke means to stimulate or give rise to reaction or emotion. People will irritate you. They will annoy you or stir up anger. And this other wife provoked and irritated Hannah. And it moved her to the place of depression. When you're crying all day and you don't want to eat nothing, that's a sign of depression. It's okay to say, I feel depressed today. Let me go over here. Some of us are so super spiritual. That's how I feel. But that's not who I am. That's how I feel. See, some of us make declarative I am statements rather than just acknowledging how we're feeling. I don't have to absorb that or become that. I'm just saying, this is how I feel right now. This is what I'm going through right now. But I believe that the sovereign God, the omnipotent God, the omnibenevolent God is somehow still working on my behalf. And you're going to see that Hannah persisted in her faith. See, sometimes the provocation is pushing you to prayer. You are provoked and God is allowing you to be provoked so you can pray. God is allowing you to be perturbed so you can pray. God is allowing you to be perplexed so you can pray. Some of us are perplexed, perturbed, and provoked. Go to work every day and we're triggered. Why don't you trigger yourself down to the altar and pray? God's trying to trigger you into transformation. God is trying to push you to the place where you stop trusting in your flesh and start trusting in him. Tell somebody, I'm triggered, all right, to get on my knees. I'm triggered to get back into my word. I'm triggered to get back into fellowship. I'm triggered to start going back to worship. I'm triggered to start getting some real accountability. I'm triggered, all right. I'm triggered to do some warfare in the spirit realm. I'm triggered to raise my spiritual game. I'm triggered to take up the weapons of warfare, which are not carnal, but they are mighty for the pulling down of strongholds. I'm triggered to get back into his presence. So this wife is triggering her and provoking her. And poor Elkanah, we just trying to help. Because Elkanah comes and said, baby, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart sad? Am I not more than 10 sons to you? And I can see Hannah now, Elkanah. I love you, but now's not the time. Husbands, sometimes we can't identify with the pain of our wives. But God can. And so as men, we have to shift to a place of intercession. Certain stuff your wife going through, you only going to help her through prayer. Now, you already gave her the double portion of the meat. You done asked your question and got your response, so you can't now become her rival as she's dealing with other rivals. You've just got to take a step back and you got to allow the sovereign God to do what only God can do. And so here, after they had eaten and drunk in Shiloh, Hannah rose. So she's going to get up now. I told you, you start here, but then you have to start taking actions to get out of your pity party. You got to take actions. And for some of us, we got to get up. We got to get out of the bed. We got to get off of the couch. We got to get off of the gossip line. You talking to your friends, it ain't helping. It's making it worse. You need to get up and you need to go talk to God. So Hannah rises up and she goes to the temple. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple. She was so deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. This is not intelligible worship and prayer. This is a crying out. This is nasty worship. You know when the snot is running from your face, and ladies, the mascara is running, and your wig is shifted, and your edges, and you ain't even worried about it. I ain't even worried about that right now, because I've got something going on inside of me, and it's tearing me apart. But the only person that can deal with this is God. That's how she's playing. That's how she's praying. And she's here, and she's praying, and she's crying out, as she vowed a vow before the Lord, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your servant and remember me and not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a son, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall touch his head. And she continued praying before the Lord, and Eli observed her mouth. Now, what I'm imagining is that if she's just mumbling, but her spirit is speaking in her mind, she's talking to the Father. Eli doesn't know what she's saying. All he sees is erratic behavior. All he sees is someone that looks a little bit off, because his role was to protect the worship atmosphere. Thank God for the people that protect the worship atmosphere. If something strange is happening, you need the pastoral assistants to step in and say everything all right. And that's godly. But sometimes, in the effort to make sure everything is all right, sometimes we misread things. Pastors are human. We're not perfect. Eli misread something. Eli thought she was drunk. Said, baby, you can't come here drunk. I don't know what you do out there, but in here, this is a consecrated space. He was observing her mouth, and Eli was like, look. But listen, the scripture says Hannah was speaking in her heart. Only her lips moved and her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli took her to be a drunken woman. And Eli said to her, how long will you go on being drunk? Put your wine away. Now, some of y'all would have been done. Earrings would have come off. Wig would have slid off. My womb is barren. That woman in my house is provoking me and irritating me every day. And all I wanted to do is get into the presence of the Lord. And here you come. And then we would have given some adjectives. You sit here, you sitting at the old man, this and that. But look at Hannah. Hannah is a model, because Hannah said, no, my Lord, I'm a woman troubled in spirit. I have neither drunk wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. In other words, I haven't been pouring any liquor. I've been pouring out my soul. This is free. Stop pouring the Henny. And start pouring out your spirit before God. And I know we all saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Spirit, but some of us have been given too much wine. You're drinking wine to go to bed at night. You need a drink to calm your nerves. And God is saying, I want to teach you how to let me calm your nerves. Let me give you rest. Because although your nerves are calm, your mind is still restless. Your spirit is still restless. You can't just pour a drink. You need to pour out your spirit before the Lord. That's what prayer does. That's what worship does. That's why it looks like at times people have lost their mind. They're not losing their mind. They're pouring out in the spirit. If you're going to be drunk in the spirit. Be drunk in worship. Be drunk in prayer. Get to the place where you are completely inebriated by the Spirit and the Holy Ghost. She said, I haven't been drinking, sir. And watch, see, that's how we know she was in the spirit. Because your flesh would want to go off, but the spirit is leading her. The spirit is trying to position her. Spirit's trying to give her an alley-oop, because God's about to slam dunk. But you got to recognize what the spirit will temper you, because, see, the blessing is on the other side of your obedience. And the spirit will say, nope, don't go off. Because the very person that originally offended you might be the person to release you and bless you. You already going off on the officer without realizing that the officer has the ability to set you free. And maybe he approached the car a little wrong. But what you do now may determine whether you leave here blessed or in a worse position. So Hannah, filled by the Spirit, even in the midst of her distress, answers. Says, do not regard your servant as a worthless woman. For all along I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and my vexation. And then Eli answered, go in peace. The God of Israel grant your petition that you have made to him. And she said, let your servant find favor in your eyes. And then the woman went away and ate, and her face was no longer sad. I'm going to stop right there. That's enough. I got more, but I need you to understand that in that moment, she could have allowed the misunderstanding to cause her to miss her blessing. Now, if you keep on reading about Eli, Eli had some issues. Eli had sons that were supposed to inherit the priesthood, and they were out of control. Eli had grown dense in his spiritual awareness. As he grew older and his eyes grew dimmer, so spiritually, but in that moment, God sobered him up. There was still a connection with the Father because of the office in which he walked. And in that moment, watch this, he blesses her. That distressing spirit goes away, and now she's at peace and she can eat again. But watch this, not only did Samuel solve the dysfunction of her family, Samuel solved the dysfunction of the priesthood. Because Eli's sons weren't fit to be the judge of Israel, but here comes this woman whom Eli blesses, and her son is the one who becomes the last great judge of Israel, thus fulfilling what that role was supposed to be. And so Samuel not only fixed the dysfunction of her family, but the dysfunction of the body to go find a man named David through whom Jesus eventually came. But what if she had given up in the midst of her trauma? What if she had let the other woman drive her to a place of just losing her mind? What if she got to the place where she just detached herself from the temple? Over misunderstanding. Do you know that Hannah, we're closing now. Do you know that Hannah is the only woman in scripture recorded of making a vow and fulfilling that vow? The prayer that Hannah prays after this encounter, after God blesses her womb, is the longest prayer recorded in scripture. And in that prayer, she was so aware of the true nature of God, she called out the name of Yahweh more than any other prayer in all of Scripture. And from her womb, which was at one point barren, came Samuel. And Samuel was so key to the history of God's people. You can't allow your trauma to hinder you from triumph. Pastor Tanya, you came in my office this morning and you said, I sense a fragrance at the altar. You said the fragrance of what, angels? That's real spooky. That's deep. You know, sometimes people say something deep and you ain't got nothing to respond. Like, bless the Lord. That's deep. I wish I was that deep. But as you were saying that, I had just finished my notes. You see the flowers on the screen, right? Let me give you my final scripture. 2 Corinthians 2:14, but thanks be to God, who in Christ always leads us into triumphal procession, and through us spreads the fragrance of the knowledge of him everywhere. For we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. When we move from trauma to triumph, we know that Christ leads us in triumphal procession. And through us, when we embrace the victory that he's given us, there's an aroma. There's an aroma. There's a fragrance. The fragrance of people who have been healed. The fragrance of people who know who their Savior is. The fragrance, the fragrance, the fragrance, the fragrance. When a womb is open, when a wound is open and it bleeds, it creates a stench. But when that wound is healed and that scar comes, it's a reminder of what you've been through, but also a reminder of your healing. As some of us need to close the wounds. We've been bleeding for way too long. And when you bleed for way too long, you bleed on people. And God is saying, I want to wrap your wounds today. I want to seal your healing process. And when you're out in the wild, sometimes you got to take some heat and seal that thing up. And it hurts. But it's better than allowing infection to spread and to continue. There's a fragrance that God wants from his people. But you got to come correct to the sovereign God. And you got to know that he's omnipotent, he's omnibenevolent. You need to know that he has a plan in spite of whatever you're going through. So here's what I need. I need you to say, I need the worship team on the stage. If this resonated with you, I need you to run up to this altar. If you need a defining moment to move you from your place of trauma into triumph, if you know this message was for you, I'm praying for a demonstration of power now, demonstration of authority now. I'm going to ask our pastoral leadership team, we're going to do something different. I want you guys to come up to the stage. We don't have time to lay hands on everybody, but I need my pastoral leadership team and elders on this stage. Bishop and Lady Sharon, if you would come forward as well. There's some things that need to be broken today. You remember on the Power Rangers? We're not talking about TV shows no more, but, you know, let's continue. In Power Rangers, you had five rangers, and they would compete individually, and they get overcome by whatever enemy was there at that moment. And then what would they do? We need Megazord power. Watch this, and they would come together. They would come together because there was strength and there was authority when they came together. There was a power that was released when the entire team was assembled. And so right now we're standing in the full power and authority of this house. Our overseers are here. The elders are here. The pastors are here. And we're going to believe that there's going to be a flow right now. Come on, begin to lift your hands. Come on, begin to lift your hands. Begin to lift your hands. Pastoral leadership team, just begin to pray whatever you sense. Come on, declare it, decree it in this atmosphere. Come on, we declare healing in this atmosphere. We declare healing in this moment. We declare power in this moment. These folks are not defined by their trauma, but they're being defined by the identity of a Christ who became trauma so that we can become righteous. We lean upon his work on the cross right now. We thank you for the power of the blood. We thank you for the authority of the Spirit. We thank you that according to Scripture, all things are working together. We're not standing on our emotions. We're standing in the strength of the Scripture. We're standing in the power of the Word that was written. And we are declaring your Word, O great and mighty God. Just as Hannah went before your presence and declared your eternal rule, we call out to the Lord of hosts. We call out to Yahweh. We call to you specifically, God. We're not talking to any of these little g gods that have no power. In fact, every little g god that people at this altar have been relying upon, may they fall right now in the presence of a holy God. Whether it's the little g god of alcohol and substance abuse, let that idol be destroyed today. Whether it's witchcraft and Santeria, whether it's all types of voodoo to try to get the, when you're trying to smudge sage to try to get a word, you're playing with Ouija boards and stuff, let all those things fade away because the power and the authority of the Almighty God, the Omnipotent God, the Omnibenevolent God is in this place. And his rule shall be recognized. Let every other name fall to the wayside at the name of Jesus, the Son of Yahweh. Hallelujah. Lord, we ask for your spiritual authority in this moment. We ask for your glory cloud to descend. We ask for your power to descend. We ask for your power to descend right now. You know every need of this altar. You know the blockages. You know the hindrances. You know the idols. You know the history. You know what someone did to someone at this altar, yet you are greater than all of those things. We lean into spiritual reality right now, supernatural reality. With men, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. And so, Father, we speak breakthrough, 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 healing, 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 deliverance, deliverance. Deliverance. Close the wound now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Close the wound now in the name of Jesus. Heal the trauma, Father, in the name of Jesus. Heal the trauma in the name of Jesus. Close the door in the name of Jesus. Move your people from trauma to triumph, from victim to victory. According to your word, we are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. We stand on your word right now. We stand on your truth. Holy Spirit, do your work. Holy Spirit, do your work. From the left to the right, from the brunt to the back, from those in this physical place and those online. Holy Spirit, move by your power. Come on, wave of the Holy Spirit, move. If they need to be broken down, break them down, Holy Spirit. If they need their tears to be dried up, some of them have been crying for way too long. Miraculously, you're going to dry up the tears and they're not going to cry about the same thing anymore. Some people need a different conviction. They need the tears to finally fall so they can feel, so they're no longer numb to what's happening in their life, but so that they know that your reality supersedes even their natural reality. Father, would you move with your power? Holy Spirit, would you have your way? Holy Spirit, would you have your way? Holy Spirit, would you have your way? Have your way. Have your way. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Healing, breakthrough, deliverance. Deliverance, 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 deliverance. No more going back, but going forward. No more going serving. No more going in circles, but sure deliverance, sure healing in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. 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 Until I overflow, I want to run. Come on, I want to run over. Come on, we need a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. Fill me up. Until I overflow, I want to run over. I want to run over. Come on, make this your cry. Fill me up. Until I overflow, I want to run over. I want to run over. I want to run over. Come on, fill me up. I want to run over. I want to run over. I want to run over. Come on, fill me up. Come on, Holy Spirit, do what only you can do. Meet every row, every person. Meet them in the midst of their cry. Meet them in the midst of their prayer. Meet them in the midst of their request. Hear them like you heard Hannah. 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 Fill me up. Fill me up. Until I overflow. I want to run over. Come on, this is our anthem today. Fill me up. Come on, this is your song. This is your declaration. Fill me up. Until I overflow. I want to run. 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 Hey.
I want to run over.
I want to run over.
I want to run over.
I want to run over. I want to run over. I want to run over. Come on. I want to run over. I want to run over. I want to run over. Come on, fill me up. Until I overflow. I want to run over. I want to run over. Come on. Fill me up. I don't want to stay on that couch. I want to get up. I don't want to wallow in my depression. I want to walk towards deliverance. I want to be healed. I want to be healed. I want to be healed. Fill me up. I want to run over. Fill me up. I want to run. 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 Hey. There's about to be one demonstration of power and then one demonstration of peace. Some of you are expecting God to move. God's gonna move right now. Someone may or may not be laying hands on you, but the power of the Holy Spirit is going to hit you exactly where you need it. Come on, we're gonna go for the power, then we're gonna go for the peace. If you need the power, lift your hands now. Lord, there are hundreds of people in this room. There's only a few of us, but you're omnipresent. Hallelujah. Father, as I pray this prayer, let it be as if a pastor or an elder or an intercessor is laying hands in the oil. Let it be as if the hand of God is on a person's belly. Let them feel your tangible presence. Father, we speak with power. Father, we speak with authority. All light, no darkness. The King is here. He's ruling and he's reigning. We speak to every contrary spirit that is not in accordance with God's word. We speak with power and we pray for breakthrough right now in the name of Jesus. We refuse to live beneath your standard, Father. And so we access your power now. Father, let your power fall. Let it impact every person under the sound of my voice. That needs a touch, let the Spirit touch them right now. If they're online, let the power of the Spirit reach them right now. Let your power be demonstrated. If they need healing and relief, let the healing and relief come as confirmation that you are with them. If the enemy won't be silent in their head, we speak with the power and the authority of the Holy Spirit that the enemy must be silenced now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, receive his power. Come on, he's touching each and every person that needs it. The woman with the issue of blood pressed into the crowd and touched the hem of his garment. Hallelujah. 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 Your press matters. You can press to touch and to reach out to him. And your reaching out can do something. And he reaches back through the power of his Spirit. Hallelujah. Strongholds broken. Hallelujah. That word about drinking, that was for somebody. Put the bottle down. It's not helping you. You need the Spirit of God. You need the fellowship of the saints. You need the understanding of God's word. And today is the beginning of your deliverance. But you've got to want to be delivered. God will meet you in your place of desire. But you need to first agree that what you've been doing is not working. And God wants to meet you and begin to give you the plan. Maybe it's going to a recovery program. Maybe it's checking yourself into Pivot. Maybe it's going to the Isaiah house. But the healing begins now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I speak divine wisdom. Divine wisdom regarding next steps. As your power is flowing, your power will continue to guide your people where they need to go. And now, Father, now that we've prayed for power, we now receive your peace. Now receive your peace. A peace that surpasses all understanding. We receive it now. Come on, do you feel this peace now? Some of you got some voices that have been in your head, and they must submit to the peace and the rule of a holy God. He's landing now. He's resting. His shalom, nothing missing, nothing broken. Peace. Peace. Be still. Peace. No more anxiety in his presence. Peace. You got a major decision, but God's going to show you what to do. Peace. You don't know how to handle your kids, but you just feel a peace that God is going to help you navigate. Peace. Peace. Rest. Peace. Peace. Silly peace. Peace that doesn't make sense. Illogical peace. Peace that just doesn't make sense for what your finances and current living situation. It's the type of peace in the midst of what you're going through, not apart from it. Let the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, rest upon you. May the power of God, which is not confined to this worship service or the person holding the microphone, but through the power of the Holy Spirit, who's everywhere that we can't be, may God continue to work in your life. And may you move beyond your trauma to walk in triumph and victory. And may this moment matter. May we mark this moment and remember this as the day that our healing and deliverance came. And may your blessing and your favor rest upon your people. This we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. And with gratitude, let's say amen. Amen. Amen.